Hello everyone, welcome to my channel. Today I'm bringing you a person that's very, very special and very important to me. And I'm so grateful to have him in my life. His name is Alex and he's my friend from Spain. And he's one of the brightest people that I know. Today we're going to be talking about Buddhism and about why should you embrace Buddhist values and principles to make your life better. So I think everyone needs to hear his words.
Okay, so first of all, I would like to make an important clarification, and that is that to me, Buddhism is not a system of beliefs, a closed religion that you have to enter when you have some kind of faith or by performing some kind of ritual or by taking in some kind of teacher. But it's rather just a method, even a psychological method designed to stop human suffering, because that was the Buddha's main goal. His quest for enlightenment was none other than to search the root of suffering and to put an end to it and to share it with everyone.
How would you explain to someone who knows nothing about Buddhism, what is Buddhism, like in a very simple, basic way?
Is the pursuit of happiness by removing suffering. That's the essence. How do you do that? That is through the Four Noble Truths. So the first noble truth is recognizing that the world is unsatisfactory. Mm-hmm. You're never going to reach a stage where something external to you is going to give you ultimate happiness.
It's the cause of human suffering. The human nature is suffering.
Exactly, because the moment you're desiring something outside of yourself, so for example, I'm desiring, I don't know, having a new computer or having a new phone or having a better camera. Well, that moment I am in a way getting in debt, right? Because when you get in debt, you're saying, well, I need this thing and I need to get there. So I already not have it. So I have a lack. And that feeling of lacking is something that I think is very prevalent in human nature, and specifically nowadays where there's so many things outside and we're constantly finding ourselves desiring for something that is outside of us.
So basically, so now you're talking about the second noble truth, right? Which is the cause of human suffering, which would be clinging and craving for external things.
And then the third noble truth is that there is a cessation to that suffering. You can put that suffering to an end. And the final noble truth is there is a path that leads to that cessation of suffering.
Yeah, which will be the Eightfold Path that the Buddhists claims that it's the way that you follow in order to reach the state of nirvana or just full liberation of suffering.
Exactly. That's right. And I think that an interesting to mention, when you look at the Four Noble Truths, the order is a little bit curious, because you could think, all right, first noble truth, there is suffering. Second noble truth, there is a cost of suffering. And the third noble truth is there is an end to suffering. And the fourth is there is a path. So someone could ask themselves, why isn't there is a path the third noble truth? And finally, there's a stop as the last noble truth. And that the reason, in my opinion, is that Buddhism is like going to a doctor. So when you go to a doctor, they tell you, well, you have an illness. That's the first thing they told you. Second thing they tell you is this illness, this is the root. So this virus or this bacteria. And then they tell you, well, there is a cure. So they give you some hope. There is a cure. And then they tell you, they write a prescription. All right, you're going to have to take this medicine, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So this is a way of looking at Buddhism that I think is very accurate, because it's like going to the doctor. All human beings have this problem, this illness, which is not being satisfied at the full extent completely. And so the Buddha is like a doctor and tells you what is, you know, the full recipe to put an end to your illness.
And I do feel like people take Buddhism in a way that they make it sort of a religion in order for them to stop and actually listen to what Buddhism is talking about. Because there's a quote I really like from the 14th Dalai Lama that says that don't take what you learn from Buddhism to be a Buddhist, take it to be a better wherever you already are. which I find it really interesting because the teachings from Buddhism, they don't have to be sort of thing that you are taken into a religious path, but you just become the best version of yourself. So because it's very self-centered, when you ask something, you ask it to yourself and you make yourself better, not asking for, like when you go to the church and not being preaching against Catholicism or anything, but you are asking an external thing to be able to help you. In Buddhism, you ask yourself.
Buddhism is more about that inner work that you're talking about and looking at your own bowl rather than looking at other people's, and having other people also as a reflection of your own faults. So one of my favorite quotes, one of the ones that I find most encouraging in the Buddhist path, is nirvana is the tendency of seeing perfection in others. So that means that full liberation is when you do not see fault, when you do not see imperfection in other people. So that is, so long as you see people doing wrong things, or every time the thought comes to your mind, why is he doing that? Why is she doing that? That's wrong. That means that you're not enlightened. So that is a constant turn of the attention to yourself, which I find very, very practical and very effective.
For example, like the five precepts, I find very interesting because they are not only in Buddhism, but also in other religions. So it's like, do you know them? Like, don't kill, don't steal, don't indulge in sexual misconduct, don't lie, so use your voice wisely. And the fifth one
is do not drink alcohol or substances that will confuse you.
Yeah, so to have your mind clear. So it's all about focusing on your mind in order to optimize so that you can release yourself, because then you realize that all the thoughts that you are having, you are the watcher that is behind those thoughts. You are not those thoughts.
Buddhism and precepts is a funny one because there's the five basic precepts, which are the ones that we just talked about. And those are for lay people to observe. So for people who are not in a monastic community. If you ask, for example, a Theravada monk, they have 227 precepts that they have to memorize and respect. The basic idea behind the precepts is provide a structure, a model of conduct.
It's just the teachings that you can get, even if someone doesn't want to call itself a Buddhist or doesn't want to go and become a monk or go into the Eightfold Path. But just take these basic teaching so that you can make yourself better while still engaging in society. Because I feel that when people see Buddhism, they see the monks, so they just let all the material possessions and go pursue a very monastic life. And just, for example, most of the branches of Buddhism are very focused on meditation, because this is the way that you can practically just detach yourself from your body and be able to watch your own thoughts. And just this simple practice that you take from Buddhism can actually make you a better person in your day-to-day lives, because like what I'm talking about is not to bring someone into Buddhism, or just see what you can learn from Buddhism so that you can be a better person.
Meditation is something that is not particular of Buddhism or of any religion. Meditation is something that is particular perhaps to the human, to humans. So I think that, in my opinion, instead of embracing the five precepts, I think it could be more helpful to someone to just start meditating and see what effects does that have. I think that's a far more interesting practice to start than to look at the religious doctrines or rules or anything or any such thing.
People see meditation as a thing that they're very scared, like how just sitting like bored, doing nothing, just with my thoughts, I'm losing time, I could just be learning something or be with my friends. Or how would you get someone into meditation, and which step would you say it's the first step they should take?
Instead of sitting down and meditating, I would say the first step would be to think about your life, your day-to-day, and try to remember or think of the moments where you forget that yourself exists. So moments where you're so into the present moment doing a particular activity, and how does that feel? So if you're an athlete and you enjoy playing soccer, how does that feel where you're in the field and you forget about everything else and you're just currently in the moment? Is that a good feeling? Is that a bad feeling? Same applies to artists, dancers, anyone. Whenever you lose yourself in the present moment, that is a kind of meditation, a one-centered focus. Because that one-centered focus is what leads to peace. So everyone has experienced this kind of meditation. Mm. However, formal meditation where you sit down and you try to focus in, for example, the breath, that is the next step. And like everything in life, that's something that you have to do very gradually, slowly. But in order to take away the fear and to encourage people to meditate, I would suggest looking at your own life and seeing how it feels when you have these moments of just complete focus, because that is what you achieve with meditation.
I could mention Zen meditation, Zen Buddhism, for example, which I think it's a very interesting branch, because it's basically when you're doing something, you're doing one thing at a time. You're not focusing on different things. If you're washing dishes and you're just washing dishes, if you're walking, you're just walking. Like related to what you were saying, it's a kind of meditation that you can do just by living, just by focus on one activity at a time. So what would be simple habits that you could take from Buddhism that people could do every single day?
Again, the most important thing I would say is to cultivate distance from your own mind. Mm-hmm. Nowadays, we have the problem that we think we are our own mind. And every time our mind says, you're dumb, you're doing this wrong, this person doesn't love you, go and get that, I want this food, I want this person, I hate this. That is just creating more suffering. And the only way to really fix that is not by suppressing those thoughts. That will never work. Mm-hmm. I can talk from experience here. The best way to do that is to gain some distance, to not believe your thoughts. I find that to be a very liberating thing, to just let the mind rumble and talk and just not believe it. Just, you know, you get this sense of freedom, because when you believe everything your mind does and you're a slave to your mind, basically, then you're always tied up. It's like having fetters and being in a prison. And real freedom, real peace, in my opinion, is measured by the distance you have to your own thoughts and to your own mind. So, talking about habits, how do you get distance from your mind? Well, of course, meditation is the most important practice, because as I mentioned earlier, it allows you to see your mind from an unbiased perspective and from a distance, almost as if this mind was not yours. So maybe you could try considering just looking at your own mind as if it wasn't yours. I think that's an important habit. And then, of course, two other things would be decluttering. So having less things to do, less objects, less, just less is more. Seeing how that works for you. Try it out for a month and see if you're more peaceful or you're more worried. And then finally, do one thing at a time.
Like overall, it just makes you a better person. Because if you accept your things, and you're also not going to go to other people with your problems, and then you are kinder, and then people are kinder overall, because we have this little cloud around us. Then if we are nice and kind and we love people, then people will love us back. And how good would the world be if everyone would just love more and be kinder? So let's just sum up everything we said. And what would be your piece of advice for people? What would be the message you would like to put out in the world?
I wouldn't give any advice, really. I would give encouragement. For if you're watching this video and you suffer, just know that there is a way out of it. That through meditation and self-knowledge, you can get to that happiness. You can tap into that good feeling that you know that is very deep inside you. That for me, it's that tiny glimmer of hope that I think we all as humans have, the light at the end of the tunnel. Well, that exists. And my encouragement is, whenever you see the tunnel getting darker and darker and darker and that light disappearing, I encourage you to go straight into the light, open-heartedly. But I can assure you, I can promise you, I've been in the total darkness and there is a light. So for me, that was Buddhism. And I would suggest that a first step would be, of course, meditating and learning more about this. But the light does exist. Walk into it. Whenever you feel like it, whenever suffering propels you to go there.
That was beautiful. Very inspiring. Thank you so much.
Thank you for trusting me.